subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
As we begin this episode of Cut the Clutter, let me get something off my chest. And this is a complaint I have with our viewers. And the complaint is simply that you make me work too hard. You make me read up new things. You make me give trouble to the two young people, that is Raghav Bhikchandani and Shubhangi Mishra, who are now helping me with research. But also, you make me realize how little I know, which is a humbling thought and not a flattering thought at all. By this time, you should think that you are a sab janta wala. You've been around, been there, done that. Any question you raise, uska koi na koi jawab, some answer I can give you. But then, the beauty of my job and the reason I love my job is also that there are always surprises and there are always new things to know. So just as I say that I complain to you that you make me work so hard, don't take that seriously. What you should take more seriously is my gratitude that you make me work harder than I would and also learn new things. So we are talking about a country today that so many of you have been asking me to talk about. Particularly yesterday, I saw my responses. So many of you wanted us to talk about the developments in Nepal. And as I started reading up and following it, in fact, reading up our own stories, some done by Nainima Basu, who covers foreign affairs for us, some opinion articles we've carried, including one from KP Bhattarai. We'll share all this with you. I realized how little did I know about Nepal. This is really a case of what we call in Hindi, chirag tel tale andhera. That Nepal's next door, we seem to think that we know everything about Nepal, but we know so little. Now, let me ask you a question. If you look around India, visualize the map of India and India's neighborhood. So, which is the country, the neighbor that's most important for India? Now, it depends on what defines that importance. So if we determine our neighbor's importance in terms of the trouble they are for us or threat they are for us, then we are spoiled for choice. You can choose China, you can choose Pakistan, or depending on what the season is. At this point, I would say the season is the China season. Or you can even say China, Pakistan and hyphenate them because they are now a hyphenated threat. But if you look at the big picture, if you look at the ties, the contacts, so Bangladesh is a neighbor in whose creation India played a role and made massive sacrifices. Those are remembered. Bangladesh is now the only major country in our neighborhood which is truly friendly with India, although we've tried our best to ruin our relationship with them, particularly by letting this question of Bengali immigrants in Assam and West Bengal getting caught up in our domestic politics. But repair work is going on right now, as you can see, from the last summit between Sheikh Hasina and our Prime Minister Modi, the two Prime Ministers. There is also Sri Lanka, with which we have a lot to share, including one strong ethnic group which has ties on both sides. But if you look in the big picture, then which is the one country with which India has completely integrated or inseparable interests and ties of culture, religion, families, politics, strategic interests, and even our holy Hindu holy places, that is Nepal. So Nepal is a country which shares a big land border with India. It's also a country which we don't use expressions like buffer state anymore. Those are Cold War expressions or maybe expressions from the British imperial times. But it is a country, if there's a stable, sovereign, independent Nepal between India and China, it's a big help to India. And Nepal is a very large country. Look at the map of India. Start from the edge of Uttarakhand and go right on. You will go through all of Uttar Pradesh and Bihar and then reach the end of Nepal when you come to Bhutan. So it is a very large country. On the other side are the Himalayas. So it is also a Himalayan sentinel. Now, India's relationship with Nepal has been up and down, but everybody knows that this is a very strong relationship. I mentioned to you several factors. I said cultural, religious, political, strategic, economic. I can add one more to that, which is military, because people of Nepal and India can work in each other's countries freely. They have the free right of movement across each other's countries. They can work as nationals of those countries effectively, and also Nepal's people can serve in the Indian Army in the Gorkha Regiment. As we speak now, there are 39 Gorkha regiments. Generally, you can say that about a half of them, or little less than half of them, are soldiers whose origin is in Nepal. So when they fight for India, they don't fight as hired soldiers or mercenaries. They hire every bit as much as Indian patriots like any other soldiers. There's never been a doubt about it. And there's a large community of veterans of Indian Army in Nepal who are looked after by the Indian Army's pension system. And because these ties are so strong, Indian Army Chief and the Nepalese Army Chief, it's a convention. By convention, they are the, each one is the honorary chief or honorary general in the other army. In fact, our current army chief recently traveled to Nepal and this title was formally conferred on him. So this is a very strong umbilical relationship. This is much more than a relationship between two sovereign nations. Of course, we are two sovereign nations. That's why whatever happens in Nepal is of great importance in India. Now, you also know, we will talk about the diplomatic and strategic issues in another Cut the Clutter at some other point of time. I don't want to get distracted and take too long. But in Nepal, it's also been very tempting to play the China card with India, because Nepal is a small country. Nepal is today less than 3 crore population, so just over 2% of India, about half of India's per capita GDP. A lot of Nepalese work in India, a lot of Indians work in Nepal. Nepal also has a mixed population. Nepal also, or Nepalese elites in particular, have always had the sense that India exercises undue influence over Nepal's internal affairs. Nepal's democratic politicians in the past, going back to the days of the Nepali Congress, have been very impressed and have been very influenced by Indian Congress politicians and Indian socialists. So there is a lot of insecurity among Nepalese elites. First, it reflected in the insecurities of the royal family, as long as the royal family controlled Nepal, and then almost any government that comes to Nepal has that issue. So they know the way to play India is to use the China card, because China is as much a neighbor for them as India, although the ties of culture, religion, intermarrying, history, etc., are not there. So that goes on all the time, and that's how India has to also balance its policy. Now, we'll talk about more of this at some other point of time. Let me come back to Nepalese politics, what has happened, the headlines. The headlines are that KP Sharma Oli, who's the Prime Minister of Nepal, he has decided to dissolve, or he has asked for his National Assembly to be dissolved and a fresh election to be held. A Prime Minister can do it, but there are some complications. And in Nepal particularly, the complications are such that if in 2.5 years of an election taking place, you can still form a government within the same parliament, you should not be allowed to dissolve the assembly. So that call has to be taken by the president. President is close to Mr. Oli. That's a tradition that's now come up in the subcontinent, that presidents are ceremonial. They were always ceremonial, but now they tend to pretty much sign anything the government of the day tells them to do. So there are further complications in this, for which I have to go into slightly cluttered, not more than slightly cluttered, Nepalese politics. Now, how did this government come into being? This government is actually a coalition which became a one-party government. So, Communist Party of Nepal, that is United Marxist Leninists, UML, CPN, UMN, not M, M is India, Communist Party of Nepal, UML, and Communist Party of Nepal, Maoist Center. They contested elections in 2018 in some kind of an alliance, and I'll explain to you to the extent that I can, because it's very fascinating and very confusing. When they came, when elections were over, nobody got a majority. But CPN, UML and CPN Maoist Center, they came together. They came together and formed an alliance. And then they also included lots of chota chota Maoist parties, factions, to get them all together and got a two-thirds majority in the house. So they got about 175 seats in a house of 275. Now the leader of CPN-UML, that is United Marxist-Leninist, was K.P. Sharma Oli. K.P. Sharma Oli is a former Naxalite. He is a former Naxalite from the days when Naxalism was at its peak in Bengal in India. So it was somewhere, I think, early 1970 that he killed a farmer as a Naxal militant, killed a farmer, was caught, given the life sentence, which he served for 14 years. Subsequently, he got a royal pardon and came out. Since then, he wasn't fighting very much. The other group, that is CPN Maoist Center, is headed by Pushp Kamal Dahal, who's mostly known as Prachanda, which is his war name or nom de guerre, as they say. So Prachanda is the leader of the Maoist Center CPN. So they decided to come together and merge their party. There was another show in town. So Madhesis of Nepal, who are about 30%, who are the Madhesis? Madhesis are people who live in districts along the border with India, that is UP, Bihar, little bit of Uttarakhand. These are the border districts of what is called as Tarai. These are highly populated. So about 30% of Nepal's population is Madhesi. These are people of Indian origin, people who migrated to Nepal in the past. They are Nepalese for all practical purposes, but their mother tongue is Hindi and they have relationships on this side. So you remember in 2015, when India and Nepal had that terrible problem, when India blockaded supplies even of fuel and medicine to Nepal, Sushma Swaraj, who was then India's External Affairs Minister, she used a line which I think rankles with a lot of Nepalese. She talked about the fact, without saying so directly, but obviously referring to the Madhesis, that we have roti beti ka rishta with them. Roti beti ka rishta with them means family ties, ties of intermarrying and socializing, living together, etc. So we have roti beti ka rishta with them. How can we give up on their rights? And that dispute in Nepal had risen because Madhesis wanted a larger representation in the national constitution and they wanted certain things added to the constitution, which the majoritarian government was not willing to do, and India leaned on their side. Now, when that happened, I will go back and forth here because all these things are interconnected. When that happened and Nepal was in distress, China saw an opportunity. So China said, don't worry, you need fuel, I will open up my strategic fuel reserves. You need medicine, I'll send you as much medicine. You are concerned that India may stop your transit at any time in the future because Nepal is a landlocked country. Don't worry, come, I will help you set up transit stations on my borders with you. And that's how the Chinese came into the picture. This time, Nepal did not have to use the China card directly to sort of troll India. The Chinese came in because they saw an opening, and that I think was the first foreign policy mistake Narendra Modi made, especially in the neighborhood. He's been trying to correct it since then, but why it's difficult to correct these things in Nepal, you will realize as we talk about Nepal's politics. So this third party was the Madhesi party. Now Madhesi party was called Federal Socialist Forum of Nepal, FSFN. Now FSFN, and there was another party, Rashtriya Janata Party. I told you many of these parties are inspired by Indian politicians, particularly Madhesi parties. Chandrasekhar, for example, our former PM, used to have excellent relations in Nepal, as did Jayaprakash Narayan, as does today, say, Sitaram Yechuri. Now FSFN merged with the former Maoist ideologues party, Naya Shakti Party. The former Maoist ideologue was Baburam Bhattarai. Baburam Bhattarai, Oli is not very well educated. Prachanda has some education from within Nepal. Bhattarai, on the other hand, is very well educated. Bhattarai is a graduate of Chandigarh School of Architecture, the famous School of Architecture in Chandigarh, where he was rated to be a brilliant student. After that, he came to Delhi School of Architecture and Planning, got his master's there, and then he came to JNU to get his PhD. And I think you will be interested to know the subject of his PhD. It is Nature of Underdevelopment and Regional Structure of Nepal, : a Marxist analysis. So a likely JNU PhD thesis. So he got his PhD at JNU, and that's when he made his contacts with Indian leftists also. Remember, Sitaram Yechury was at JNU. He's only 2 years older than Baburam Bhattarai. So this party, the Madhesi party, merged with Baburam Bhattarai's party, and together they became Samajwadi party. Now, Samajwadi party and Rashtriya Janata party again merged and called themselves Janata Samajwadi party. You see how Samajwadi parties change their names and avatars in India. It's very similar in Nepal. Now, how did this alliance between the two came in? Because as we speak today, it looks like the split in the Communist Party of Nepal has more or less happened, because Oli has set up a new committee to run the party and the campaign, and that committee only has his own people. So Prachanda's people have been left out. For all practical purposes, Nainima tells me it is as if Prachanda has been expelled. As we speak, Prachanda is meeting with his people and they are coming up with it, with their next step. So it does look like the party will split into two. Each one will call itself Communist Party of Nepal. This group, that group. We know that whenever there is a Communist Party in this subcontinent, it splits and there is one group or the other group. Even the Naxalites in India initially split. There was a UCCRI, Unity Council of Communist Revolutionaries of India, Charu Majumdar group and Kanu Sanyal group. So ideology is blamed for these splits, but these splits are about power. So these two parties had come together. Now if one is decided to go for the polls, why is Oli going for the polls? Oli is going for the polls because within his own ruling party, he has lost majority support now. He's been losing it for some time and there is a reason why. And he thought he'll get around it by increasing hostility with India. And that's why he played this cartographic card of producing new maps of Nepal, showing large areas which Nepal treats as disputed since 1962. Treating those as part of Nepal. That was a big provocation for India, and India did well not to respond sharply to it, because India understood that this was done for political reasons, because he was really by that time dead man walking politically. I don't mean physically. He's had a kidney transplant, etc. But I will never say anything impolite physically about somebody, only politically. And this gave him a fresh lease of life, because with this he was able to rev up Nepali nationalism. That seems to have lost steam now. Now, to understand why this coalition is breaking or why this party is breaking, we have to understand why this party and before that why this coalition came about. And the roots of that lie in Nepal's peculiar election system. I mean, I've seen many complex democracies. I've studied many complex democracies. I know first past the post system. I know proportionate system. But the Nepalese have the best of both worlds or the worst of both worlds, depending on how you look at it. So they have both systems. That is first past the post and party proportionate representation. Now ask me, how does it work? I will take a deep breath and try and simplify it to you as much as possible. Of the 275 seats that go to the polls in Nepalese national parliament, 165 seats are elected by way of first past the post. So each party nominates a candidate, you choose a candidate. But you get a second vote at the same time. That second vote is for the party proportionate system. So 165 of the MPs get elected directly, FPTP, first past the post, as with India. All 543 in India are elected like that, but they leave 100 aside. Those 100 are then divided by all the parties in proportion to the votes they have got. Remember, we once described the proportionate representation system to you. That means that even if your party with a 2%, 3% vote collected all over India, all over the country, you can still get an MP. That is how I had mentioned to you, and I keep mentioning to you, that in Poland, National Beer Drinkers Party got a couple of seats in National Parliament. What a good idea if that could happen in India. Now, as the results of the elections came out, 2018, elections came out, no party had the majority. In fact, Oli's party just had 0.47% more votes than Nepali Congress, which is the main opposition. And it comes down, its lineage comes down from the old Nepali Congress of B.P. Koirala, etc. But it just got 0.47% more than them, so there was going to be a stalemate. At which point, Dahal, who was about 17% below Nepali Congress in terms of proportionate numbers, he and Oli decided to come together. And they said, look, we'll come together, so we add our seats and also we add the votes that we have got in the proportionate system. So our parallel votes also. So if we add all that, then we get 175, because then they also got a lot of other factions of Maoists, communists, who had got little bit of vote here and there. So they became 175 in National Parliament, and that is how this two-thirds majority came into being. I will not go into too much minutiae of Nepali politics, because it is difficult to understand and it is maybe not relevant right now, because this game is still playing out. Except to say that one thing Nepal hasn't got over all these decades is political stability. Now, one, Nepal has been a complex country. So, say, until 1959, Nepal had pure monarchy. Although there were many prime ministers under the monarchy. In fact, if you count those, that will be another about 9 or 10. I'm not going there. 1959, Nepal allowed a party to contest, and that's how Nepali Congress's government came into power, B.P. Koirala's government came into power. Soon enough, they were dismissed by the king, and the king himself then took over direct reins of the country, no pretense of democracy. That went on for a couple of years. 1962, the king brought in the panchayat system, as it was called, and allowed elections under it. Now, between 1962 and now, that is 58 years, Nepal has had how many prime ministers? Guess. Nepal has had, at my last count, 49 prime ministers. So, they are, if Oli now goes and someone else becomes prime minister, Nepal would have completed a half century of prime ministers in 58 years. And it's possible they might have completed it already, in case I missed somebody who was acting prime minister. If you see these prime ministers, it's like we've known all of them all the time. So I first went for a story on Nepalese politics in 1983, and I will share that story with you. You can see it on the screen for India Today. That is when the government of Surya Bahadur Thapa, the prime minister, was dismissed by the king, and Lal Bahadur Chand took over. Now look at the Nepalese prime ministers. You might say 49 prime ministers in 58 years. But it is not 49 people. So Surya Bahadur Thapa, prime minister 5 times, in fact 6. If you take a very short stint as prime minister in the 50s, when he was actually in his 20s, when the king was ruling directly. So Surya Bahadur Thapa 5 or 6 times. Lal Bahadur Chand, who had replaced him when I had gone there for that story, 4 times. But 4 times, all of 4 times add up to 4 years. G.P. Koirala, 4 times, all of 4 times add up to just a few years. Then, Sher Bahadur Duba, 4 times Prime Minister, but Prime Minister for all of 5 years. Prachanda, twice Prime Minister, but for all of 2 years. Madhav Nepal, who is now with Prachanda in his Communist Party, Prime Minister once. Jhalanath Khanal, Prime Minister once in 2011, but for a few months. Then Baburam Bhattarai for 2 years, then Khilraj Regmi, acting Prime Minister for a few months. So Prime Ministers and Prime Ministers and Prime Minister, and Oli himself has been Prime Minister twice, together just over 2 years. So this is a country with a lot of instability, and in the period the country has had many systems. Pure monarchy, then elected government with monarchy, then panchayat system, then constitutional monarchy, and then a democratic republic, but ruled by communist parties. So some people like to say that Nepal is the fifth communist country in the world. That is after China, North Korea, not a classical communist state. It calls itself DPRK, Democratic Public Republic of Democratic People's Republic of Korea. But China, North Korea, Cuba, Laos, Vietnam, and sixth is Nepal. But Nepal is not a communist country. It's a communist country only to the extent that communist parties are in power, and these are divided communist parties. Its system is not communist, its constitution is not communist, its pretense is not communist. But underlying all this is all these complications of this very, very cluttered electoral system, which causes many problems going ahead, and also the many factions of communist parties. These are all comrades of the past who become buddies now. In fact, you want to know more complications about Nepal? I will tell you. When Prachanda and Oli came together, they had a deal which they kept secret, but like everything good, it leaked very quickly. Like everything interesting, when I say as a journalist good, usually I mean interesting. So it leaked very quickly. What the deal said was that they will exchange prime ministership after halfway through the term. So half the time Oli will be prime minister and then the other half Prachanda. But soon enough it became evident that Oli had no intention of doing so. Then they said, all right, you still have to share power because we are different parties that came together. So another deal was offered whereby Oli would stay as prime minister, but he will give up his position as the president of the party. So leave the party in the control of Prachanda. So one man, one post. But soon enough, it also became evident that Oli was not going to keep that promise. When that happened, Nepali Congress had sharpened their kukris already outside. And then Madhav Nepal, Baburam Bhattarai and Prachanda, they were all chafing. And it looked like they will pull down his government. Then he played his new nationalist trump card of issuing his new maps of Nepal, incorporating many territories which are part of India's map. So that was his way of creating a grand distraction. That has finished its use-by date. That is over. You still want to know more complications in the Nepalese political system? In the national elections, each party has to have one-third women elected. If a party is not able to get one-third women elected, then it has to use its quota under the proportional representation to get the number of women to one-third in its national parliament strength. And it's an interesting thing that in Nepal now the president is a woman and chief election commissioner is also a woman. In fact, just as a passing mention, she is now also married to our former chief election commissioner, Mr. S.Y. Qureshi, and they are friends of ours.